of something that I want so much.
Yeah, welcome to Academy of Tone 202, remembering the great Gary Moore. Well, Gary Moore would have had birthday tomorrow on the 4th of April. He would have been 72. And I'm a big fan of Gary Moore. I was heavily influenced because he was shocking me with his energy. And some of you guys might know Gary Moore only from the blues days. This is like 1990 and what was coming after that. But the stuff that he was doing before that, back in the 80s, is what has got me. I remember when I was seeing a live performance of Gary Moore on German television, Rockpalast, I think it was around the time of this record here. This one is made live in Japan, but this is 1984. And I was watching something on television, and well, it started and then it took off. And at the moment where you thought nothing could get any higher or more intense, Gary was getting it to the next level. I mean, this was so impressive. And it's an emotional experience. For me, there are great guitar players out there, but Gary Moore is one of my all-time favorites and my heroes. And funnily enough, this red Stratocaster that he played that night was a 61 Fender Stratocaster. That guitar made me want to buy a real vintage guitar, because I was playing a Stratocaster at that age already, but I was so impressed about what he was doing that I thought, I need exactly what this guy is having. And yeah, so this was a very influential moment for me. And the people on this record is Don Airey, now with Deep Purple, and Ian Paice on drums. I mean, I played with both of them. It's the elite of the British rock scene. And by the way, we will have a nice interview with Geoffrey Whitehorn, who is about the same age, who knew very much about Gary Moore since they met in the past. So stay tuned for that interview, which is being recorded just previous to this live stream here. So we will play this in a while. As you can see, I bought many of these live recordings because I was flashed about the energy that Gary Moore was putting on stage. Just sheer emotion, sheer, I don't know, power. It blew me away. And here's another great live album. This one, We Want More. and looking at the back here, you can see he had a very simple rig, which was mainly a bunch of Marshall stacks and a simple trick with pedals. But we dive into that sound topic later. And here you can see his touring. The touring went, this was 1984, of course, Europe, Hamburg, Markthalle. I played there and recorded my Bluegrass Hendrix there. So I smelled the same backstage as Gary. Frankfurt, Cologne, the Netherlands, Nijmegen, Brussels, blah, 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 Nuremberg, Munich. He was big in Germany. But then in May, he was in the USA, Tucson, Las Vegas, Reno, Salt Lake City. So he was Los Angeles, San Francisco, Tacoma, June. Okay, yeah, there's a lot of US states here, Detroit, Milwaukee, blah, blah, blah. And then back to the UK, Donington, Monsters of Rock, Vienna, Stadthalle, Karlsruhe, Monsters of Rock, all the important rock festivals in the 80s he was playing there. And of course he was a great live act. So if you have not heard or seen Gary Moore live, I want you to check out the stuff you can find in the internet. It's amazing. I mean, Parisian Walkways, the end, it's a classic. I found some great Gary Moore's best solo, whatever. Look on YouTube and feel the energy. It's like he put so much heart into this. Okay. I want to talk a little bit about the career and the stages of his career, his style. And I find this an interesting journey. And this journey is showing that he was a true artist. He was playing different styles at different times. So he dedicated kind of 10 years for whatever, fusion with Colosseum, and then he was more into the rock thing, and then he went into the blues. And so he has done different things, and his chops were always outstanding. And to me, that's a good example for us guitar players, that the chops that you learn in any genre can be used in another genre. All the stuff that he learned from the fusion or jazz rock, the licks he could apply into blues. And that's why he was an outstanding blues player, because besides the cliche or the, you know, standards blues, he had something else in his arsenal to surprise people with, and he did. Yeah. I see a few comments here. Yeah, there is William Lee, Gary Moore, Greg Lake, Nuclear Attack. Yeah, great songs from that period, which was the first time I experienced Gary Moore. And I came back to the stuff that he did before. And then, of course, I discovered the new stuff that was coming about. One thing I wanted to mention here is I met Gary Moore personally maybe two or three times. The first time I was at a London guitar show back in the days, and I was doing a Eugen Kettner demo of the good old A64. And I was just, you know, talking to somebody and demoing it. And then I turned around, and then here he was with this, I think, blue, what is it, overall, you know, this kind of, these days, people that collect the bins, the dust bins on the streets, they have that outlook. But this was totally hip back in the 80s. You know, the one piece overall. And I think he was wearing a blue one that day. And then I met a very interested, open, but very calm guy. Had nothing to do with that massive monster he was on stage. So I explained a little bit, blah, blah, blah. And that was about it. You know, I did a job, and I tried to be not too much impressed about him being my hero that he was back in the days already. So that was the first time. Maybe the more later, when in 2004, when the Stratocaster became 50 and I got awarded, I was there with all the guys. And I mean, David Gilmour and, you know, Brian May and Hank Marvin. And Gary Moore was sitting on a flight case, very calm, very, very soft in a way. I was it was a bit weird for me. His handshake was super soft. I was expecting somebody with a little bit more power. And he became that animal on stage afterwards, that same night. Unbelievable. Everybody should watch that Red Stratocaster performance of Red House in B minor with Gary Moore from the Strat Pack. I nearly made it on that DVD as well, but Fender USA told me not to play. I was rehearsing anyway, but that's a different story. Fender, dirty laundry. I'm not washing this now. And then there was another thing that I got connected with Gary Moore. One is the book that I got from George Hoffman, who sadly passed away last year. And he's in that book many times. He is like the German booker of a lot of guitar acts, and he knew Gary very well. And this George Hoffman actually asked me to create or to found a band with Pete Rees and Graham Walker, which were the backing musicians of Gary Moore back then, like 13 years ago when Gary passed away. And so George Hoffman asked me if I could put together the band. I was also connected with Uwe Ochsenknecht, that we both knew. Ochsenknecht is a very famous German actor. And Mick Rogers, who is singer and guitar player in Manfred Mann's Earth Band. And we had kind of an all-star band, myself, Mick Rogers, Uwe Ochsenknecht, and the two guys, the rhythm section of the Gary Moore Band. And we played the Lorelei here in Germany. This was the open air. The band name was called The Screen, because the famous actor Uwe Ochsenknecht on stage, so that was our band. And we did a few more shows, but for some reason that band didn't last too long. Yeah, that's Mr. Ochsenknecht on the left, me in the middle, and Mick Rogers of the Manfred Mann's Earth Band to the right. Mick is also a killer guitar player, fantastic singer, super sweet British musician. There's something about the Brits when it comes to music, and you will find out more about that in the interview that I've done with this gentleman here. Here we go. Wait a minute. I make it nice and big. Geoffrey Whitehorn. See, this is, other size. This is Geoffrey and young Thomas having a beer in France at a trade show. And that's Geoffrey when he was the Marshall demonstrator, and Nico McBrain, the drummer of Iron Maiden. Because there was a jam band at the Marshall booth. Great times, good memories, fantastic. Back to the story of Gary Moore. There's tons of stuff you can read, like in this book, going into many, many details. I try to give you my view on the whole thing, and maybe draw my own conclusions from my point of view. Maybe you can have different views. Maybe you get different things, but I find it quite outstanding just to see a few pictures here. There's Thin Lizzy that he joined later on. There's him with a bunch of Marshall stacks, which is a typical look. The Red Strat. So he was already owning that Greeny, that famous 59 Les Paul that he got from Peter Green. for cheap, of course, or maybe not, of course, but the story is in the book, but Geoff Whitehorn tells it as he was closer than we all are in the circle. What was going on in Gary's life is he is not from London. He is basically from Dublin, North Ireland. Ireland. And this is where he had his first band, Skid Row, with Phil Lynott, who took a very important part in Gary's life. Many times he reappeared. So that's a good example of a deep friendship that was probably beyond just making music. It was being real friends. So, you know, you can see like every decade Phil was around again and again. Passing away as well. I don't know what the guys did, but they were extreme in a way. Maybe it was alcohol, maybe it was not the healthy lifestyle. That's something that I'm definitely different myself. I'm pretty much aware of what health means to me. I would never sacrifice my health for whatever, for music or anything. So that's why no drugs, no heavy excess things. And maybe that's what's missing, or that is missing, when you go to the end of the universe. And that's why we lost a lot of these people that were more extreme. And the Brits tend to have more alcohol problems, at least in that at this age group with that kind of music. It's maybe their pub mentality, and drinking is part of a culture, but it's also part of making music. And when the whole thing becomes one, you can maybe live with that for a couple of years, but then your body, you stress your body somehow. That's for sure. I'm not the expert. I'm not going into details, but all I know is I'm not going into this kind of extremes. So I hope I will live a bit longer. The thing about the celebrating of Gary's legacy is also how he was celebrating the electric guitar. When you listen to the notes that he could make, like the one note at Parisian walkways, you know, we all know that kind of, here we go. Etc. It's like, hey, who else would stand on stage and play one note and waiting for the audience to react? Like, you have to be on that extra risky level, because that note can die, you know, just brip, and then you make a fool out of yourself. But that's the kind of thing that Gary Moore went for. He went for that extra over the top, no prisoners, and sometimes even aggression, you know, the way he played his intense right hand as well. I was reading that he was left-handed, then learned the guitar like normal. And maybe that's a reason why he had such a strong attack, because you can't get his tone with a light touch. Of course, he did also do light touch, but when he go, wait a minute, let me get a less compressed sound here. It is like digging in. You can't go totally different style, although he can go. So there's a lot of dynamic. It is the soft notes and it's the punch that he puts behind the strings. And that's, for me, the most amazing part is how much energy he can put behind the strings. Because the soft notes, he is a master too. But I have seen a lot of people doing that nicely. But the way and the dirt that he can put behind strings is unbelievable. And that's why we have that album, Dirty Fingers. I think that's a pretty good album title for what Mr. Moore was doing, Dirty Fingers. And this is also interesting. You see the hand, that's something I was doing myself at that time too, like hitting hard and reaching out with the fingers, and then, you know, and by the way, what I'm using here is the classic channel, the Boost, the Strat, and not the SD1 at this point. I only use the SD1 when I need that extra push over the cliff, Spinal Tap, and this one goes to 11 then. I show you what it does. So, well, this is just the M1 delay bypass, just the reverb, and this is like okay. I know he played that on the Les Paul, but I keep the Strat for a while to explain the my connection with Gary before he was using the Les Paul a lot more again in the 90s. So I'm talking now about the 80s. Because before that, he was already, well, he had several shitty guitars, and his first decent guitar was a Telecaster. And then in the time that I recognized Gary Moore, he was holding a Strat or a Super Strat, like, you know, a Strat with humbuckers and some Van Halen style vibrato, because we're talking 80s here. And yeah, here you can see a white Strat. So for me, he was more a Strat guy because I was not knowing his past, which I was only learning afterwards. For instance, with this album, let me show you. And this one here is, it's not his first. I always thought this was his first solo record. He had one before, which was not successful, but this was his first record that was a success. And this album features the original Les Paul from Peter Green that Gary Moore owned, and the case is originally, so I was reading, from Eric Clapton. So it's a 59 Les Paul, now in the hands of Kirk Hammett from Metallica, with a case from Eric Clapton. Here is
And the album is called Back on the Streets. There is some Phil Lynott on there, I remember. And Parisian Walkways. The last song on this album is Parisian Walkways. So that's the hit that he had to play after this album, like almost every show was part of the set. Back on the Streets, Don't Believe a Word, yeah, blah, blah, blah. Hurricane, Song for Donna, What Would You Run? It, yeah, historically a very important album. It's from 78. So I only started the guitar in 1980, so 78 was before me being, being there, listening to that kind of stuff. So I bought that in 83. At that age, I was still signing my records with the year. So I can actually trace back what I was listening to at that young age. Okay. I want to explain a few of his playing things. Of course, he was influenced by all the greats before Eric Clapton. You can talk to anybody at this kind of age, 72, 70, whatever now they are. All this generation was influenced by Hank Marvin, Apache Strat player. They all loved this guy. They all liked Eric Clapton because Clapton back in the 60s with Cream was a rock guitar hero god like Van Halen in the 80s. But Clapton with Cream was a super, super group and a super guitar hero. And by the way, Gary Moore played, where is it? Let me see. Yeah, with that group later on, Jack Bruce, Ginger Baker, and Moore. So BBM was this record. That's kind of Cream without Clapton being replaced by Gary Moore. That album was later. This was 94 or 92. Yeah. So that's part of his influence. So that generation is, you can talk to them all, and they all were fans of these players for the melody and for the Clapton. Yeah, he was the fluent singing and nasty, really nasty soloists of the 60s, really creating something like the sound of rock for the guitar. I mean, these days Clapton is still cool and blah blah blah, but he is maybe not as sticking out of the crowd as much as he was back in the 60s. But hey, it's a legacy, and it's very important that he is there doing his thing, and especially for what he has done in the past. So the other thing is, being from Ireland, he had that kind of fiddle thing which comes from the folk music, and you can find that a lot in his licks. And there is like a kind of trill is a very typical Gary Moore thing, and it is a hammer on pull off, but it needs to be played in that Irish folk music style to be authentic. It's not, it needs to be fast and so it's more about the last note and not about all the details. It's that's important. That's one thing. And then there's tons of Clapton licks on steroids. And it's like when you listen to, you know, that kind of, or, you know, it's like, it's basically simple blues licks. No. But it's, the phrasing is like, no? There's the speed and the phrasing makes all the difference. I'm not the expert there. I have to admit that it's his style, and I don't know the Clapton vocabulary good enough to even put that on steroids. That's his thing. But I can hear that a lot, and that's mainly when he gets aggressive. It's kind of, get me some Clapton and put it on steroids. That's one element when he plays blues. That's Albert Collins, and Freddie King. He later then played with his heroes as well, the blues guys, and paying a tribute to them. And that was kind of his last phase in his career. But let me go back for the early roots. Of course, there was some Rory Gallagher influences. They all also knew each other and they shared stages. And, you know, the English scene is not too big. They all, you know, the UK is not so huge. And the guys all played on the same festivals and the same tours and met in the same bars. And this generation, Gary Moore, was not the generation of the Beatles and the Stones who were hanging out together in the 60s. This is more like this late 60s, early 70s, where the camaraderie of these British blues rock musicians was happening. And they all shared a similar background, and therefore they all had similar influences, but they developed their own style, each for himself, absolutely killer great. So there's a few things that I also like a lot in his style is the haunting notes and the longing notes that he was doing. We have some guests coming in. Hello. Surprise. Just say hello so we know where the noises are coming from.
Hey, Thomas.
Hey, here is the camera. Jack hello. Griffith.
Hi.
We might do something together later.
I think so, yeah.
That sounds good.
I don't want to interrupt, but we came to say hi.
Yeah, okay. Just let me finish my little lesson here on the Gary Moore thing. I don't know how much you know about Gary Moore, but...
Probably not as much as you, so let me do that.
But you're coming from the right country, so you know.
Oh, that's true.
Yeah. Yeah, anyway, for me, the thing is, you know, he plays that super longing feel and haunting notes sometimes. And I believe he is a big fan of Jeff Beck. As you will hear, when Jeff Beck brought out a new record, Gary was buying it, and the day after he already could play it because he got great ears and great technique, so he was already there. And you know, Jeff Beck,
mm-hmm.
you know, that was a sound that Jeff Beck was probably using first, and then that Gary took into his vocabulary. And then there is a lot of intense picking the right hand, and this was killing me when I was young. I had I had difficulties to come up to speed, and that's something. When you want to play like Gary Moore, you have to play like I take no prisoners. It's like, if I do a mistake, fuck it. It's like
attitude.
It's all attitude. So get some extra overdrive in front of your overdriven amp and feel like. Okay, but you get the picture. It's like, this is what impressed me so much when I was a teenager. I mean, I've never seen that kind of energy from any other guitar player. I mean, you know, Brian May, this is a cool guy, he plays killer, and all my other heroes, but nobody was playing that dirty and mean and intense. So I was just shocked, and the shock is still alive in my soul. And I can't go all the way because I'm not as intense as Mr. Moore was, but he left a big impression. Okay. Talking about sounds, he was mainly a Marshall guy, but he was able to play through anything, because when he was in any situation, he could pick up a guitar and he was sounding like Gary Moore, because he was Gary Moore and it was in the fingers. Of course, he felt right with his Marshall and whatever. I have a Governor that was famous for whatever record, another Marshall. There's nothing wrong about Marshalls, as you can see. I have tons of Marshalls. But on the other hand, you know, he did his thing with many, many, many different guitars, amps. And even though we talk about a 59 Les Paul, at the very last concerts, he had some whatever issue. I'm not the expert, R series, la la la. And he sounded like Gary Moore. And talking about the records, when you go through his fusion jazz rock days with Colosseum, Don Airey, which is John Heisman, this was kind of, how would I describe it? It's like music for adults. Complex. The blues is still there, but it was like expanding the universe into different chords, harmonies, and things. And so Don Airey was kind of a big challenge to battle with in that kind of context. Blues-based Irish folk music, then the complexity of this kind of music. And I have 3 Colosseum CDs. Then there was his, you know, big rock phase with this album here. The Corridors of Power album is the album that got me, with all the live vinyl stuff that I bought. It's melodic, it's intense, it's killer. Okay, It is 80s, so be aware of some screaming vocals. Yeah, tapping and the thrills with the with the strings like that, like. Ah, by the way, I have done a little clip that we can show you where I actually covered this part on the sofa. I think it was last year for his birthday. We can play with a little clip here.
Happy birthday, Gary Moore. Fuck war. Rest in peace.
Yeah, I think that was my birthday wish last year. But it's always... He can tell I practice his stuff. okay, this was me cherishing him with a Stratocaster. And in, I think it was 1990... Well, is it here? I don't know. Still Got the Blues came out, and that was the album that everybody knows Gary Moore from these days. He became a household name. Before that, he was a name in the scene for guitar players and the rock guys. But even my mother or my grandmother or who else knew after Still Got the Blues, there was a guitar player just like, do you know this guy? And said, oh, of course I know. No, but I knew the stuff that he was doing before that. And this album was the next phase in his career where he was, you know, coming from Ireland, then doing his first band, not so successful, moving to London, doing the Colosseum too, making another solo record, then having the success as a rock hero. And then he would, I think, made a clever move by being back on his blues roots. And I think that's a clever decision because it's much easier to age with blues than with shred metal. Mm-hmm. imagine if you are 90 and you still play the fastest licks ever in tempo 230. I mean, I don't want to go there. So I will age as a blues guy as well, learning from Gary. So, and then he was experimenting a little bit with modern, well, with kind of modern styles, with loops and synthesizers. I like that album actually a lot as well. So I'm not the blues purist. It's another great album. Yeah, I can recommend, if you are a hardcore blues guy, listen to something else once in a while. That makes you a nicer person. There's blues and ballads, of course, and then there's Dark Sides of Paradise. I think that's also like more a pop album. So Mr. Moore was experimenting a lot in genres, but he finally found the blues and did a lot in this territory. I have done, of course, with my Les Paul, a still got the blues version. With my setup here, and we can show you this little clip. And while we show you the clip, we try to make a little set change here. Okay, see you in a minute. Check out Still Got the Blues with a Les Paul.
Still got the blues for you.
Hello, we are back, and boom, quick changeover.
There we go, that's how we do it.
Jack Griffith, where are you actually from?
Well, I'm from over from the UK right now. We just arrived in Germany today. This was a total surprise, and it's really nice to see you again, Thomas. We met once about 5 years ago,
I think. I think it was at Peach
Guitars. At Peach Guitars.
There's a strange story about that performance, because I don't know if you remember, I brought out my Amp 1, and I was shooting a video that kind of never made it.
That's right. Yeah, I think I remember something happened. I don't know what happened, but the video didn't come out.
Yeah, it was probably that the sound was too good. But that's my version of
it. But anyway, this was a nice surprise. So I'm over here with Bad Cat amplifiers,
which is
hence why we have this
behind,
here
behind us. And I have to say, I'm a fan of Bad Cat. Actually, we had some Bad Cat amps here in the studio before. And of course, I do my thing, and I love my vintage gear. But if I had to choose a more modern, solid, made all tube amp, that's a very good choice. And I had
this is the jet black. So the newest
Lynx
model.
We had a Lynx.
A Lynx, and I had another one. Heiko, maybe you.
The Black
Cat,
yes.
And the Black Cat was my favorite.
Ah, well, you might like this even more, because this is a Black Cat times two. So the Black Cat was a 20 watt amplifier.
Okay. And
you know, like your kind of sounds that you like, the more the vintage, very warm kind of thing, and it has nice tremolo on board and some reverb. This is exactly the same, but now we're up to about 40 watts. And you also have a mid control on the jet black.
The other one was kind of a puristic reduced, but I liked it. I it was in the studio. It had the tone that I was connecting to easily, and it was like, you know, there's certain amps that don't turn me on in a way. It's like, and the Bad Cat stuff, they have that quality. There's some musical. I don't know. I like the guys that have the ears that voice the amps, and it's a matter of taste. But that's why I'm happy to see this amp again, because it's totally in your
ballpark.
Yeah.
Well, I can tell you that one of the reasons I really like them so much is because, you know, I've never played this particular amp. I've certainly never played this
fine
guitar before.
And boop, here
we plug straight in, and I just know that I can dial it in. You know, nothing's too extreme here.
Yeah.
We just put a bit of reverb, a bit of tremolo, and
here we go.
And I'm happy. You know? And everything else is from the guitar. Volume control, and that's super important.
Yeah.
For me, anyway.
Going back to Peach Guitars, in what was the town? I just remember there was a roundabout.
Oh, it's up in Colchester in Essex. The town that nobody's ever heard of, but it's a couple of hours out of London.
Have I been there, just by myself, or was I together with Gavin Colson? Do you remember Gavin?
I don't remember.
Ah, okay.
I don't remember, I'm afraid.
No, that's okay.
A long time ago.
Yeah, because my memories are like, I was in the UK a couple of times, and one of the demo tours that I've done with was being myself. And then I was, you know, seeing the guys from That Pedal Show, Daniel Steinhardt.
Oh, okay.
And just like you, I gave him a call and said, I'm at a roundabout, do you have time? And he said, yeah, you're the guy from the Frankfurt Show. Just come down and see us. And then roll the camera, and there was an episode which made 100,000 views.
No? Nice.
Just with Daniel. And
he's a good guy.
He's a good guy.
Dan, you're a good guy.
Yeah.
And Mick too.
And Mick I knew from my past. So Daniel was like new to me, like blind date, you know? And it worked out fine. And Mick, I spent some more time with Mick in different environments. And it's cool. And by the way, he got a 61 Strat now too.
Yes. Yeah.
He does. The buck of the 61 Strat, I think I'm part of that as well.
Oh, that's your cause? You're fighting for the 61? The holy grail of Strats?
Yeah, and this is it started with Gary Moore in my life.
Ah,
you know, when I saw this first TV appearance of Gary Moore, he was not playing a Les Paul, he was playing the 61 Strat.
The red Strat.
Yeah, and that I needed to have one. And whatever it was, I didn't know. But somebody told me it's a real pre-CBS Stratocaster.
What does that mean?
Yeah, I had no clue at that time. I was whatever.
And it sounded amazing. The great thing about Gary and Yngwie is also the same, where they just got the fattest tones.
Out of threads.
Out of single coil bridge pickup as well. Richie Blackmore as well. To me, Richie, to me, is that's the best rock strat tone of all time, is Richie Blackmore. But Gary is the same principle. Yeah. It's just take an amp, turn it up really loud.
Yeah.
And the guitar, you know, most people think of a strat as being a little bit quieter and more
weedy. Mark Knopfler-ish.
Yeah, which it does polite. Beautifully as well. But when you turn a strat up, you know this because it's your sound. But it's a totally different animal. And Gary was definitely one of the best at doing that.
Yeah. And back to Peach guitars, I mean, I remember it's one of the most beautiful shops in the UK that I've seen with, you know, like all the wooden walls.
The Western Saloon
thing. I mean,
it was
definitely... feel like in Texas, maybe.
I think that was John's idea, was to just do something a bit different.
Right.
And even now, I think people still turn up to the store and don't know what to expect. And you walk in and it's this amazing environment just stocked full of fantastic gear. But I'm very excited. I have to say, I'm very excited to check out Heiko's store tomorrow.
Oh, yeah.
So we're going to 6 and 4 Music, which I had no idea was just down the road from you.
Well, it's, you know, the thing about, there are people in this industry, and I know Heiko, for the guys who don't see him now, he is like the shop owner of 6 and 4 Musik in Sulzbach, here in my hometown. So to speak. And he's been a passionate dealer for all his life. And I think our industry is about passion. And this is why we connect. You know, it doesn't, for me, it's not a problem with any brand, or as long as we hang out and we share the same spirit.
That's right. So it comes down to people ultimately. Yeah. And like you said, you know, you can drop, as you know, we've dropped in to see you today. You dropped in to see Dan and Mick.
Yeah.
And If the vibe is right, then you connect and you play some guitar is what we should be doing.
Let's do it. Okay. Nice chord, and I was being the dirty Gary.
Well, I was trying. Yeah. But hey, how nice does this bad cat clean up?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And this is me all about that. I do it with the volume control as well. You know, I was like, by the way, have you ever seen these kind of wood things under the bridge?
No, I noticed that. It looks like little teeth. What's the deal with that?
Well, it's the mammoth teeth of the last...
the last guest.
There's a guy here in Germany who's like Germany's number one session guitar player in the studio. His name is Peter Weyer. Nobody knows him.
Okay.
But he, Bonnie M, all the old... I mean, he's like the German Steve Lukather.
Okay.
And this guy had a 58 Les Paul that was belonging to Ronnie Montrose, Van Halen, and Sammy Hager, you know, it's all this kind of American thing. So this guitar ended up with this German guitar player, Peter Weyer. And Peter is now also getting older, and somebody offered ridiculous money for that guitar.
Mm.
So he sold that 58 Les Paul.
Is it the one that was stolen from Ronnie?
Yeah. But it wasn't Peter.
I'm not accusing him. Yeah,
but the thing is, this guitar is magic and it's being heard on super sounding records.
Mm.
And it was his weapon of choice for his entire life. So, and then he got this crazy money and he thought, then he changed his life, becoming a professor at university, blah, 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 out of the session work because, you know, life changes. But then he had the problem of, I don't get my 58 sound anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And then he was connected to Gibson and they even made a replica of that guitar, but it only went that far.
Mm.
And then in the end, when he tortured the Gibson guys to the limit, he started to ask questions, how there's something missing, you know, the super stubborn German perfectionist never stops. Okay, and Peter then found a guy that was building like acoustic guitars and other things. And he said, you know what? The problem might be that the vibration of the bridge and the top connection is not perfect.
Yeah.
And then he discovered that different types of wood under this ABR bridge transfer the vibrations from the strings better to the top.
Right.
And trust me, it sounds better, whatever it is. He did it for me. I'm super happy.
So is that a particular type of wood?
Yeah. And he chose it because it's mahogany, Honduras, all forbidden stuff. You know, it's like...
So you're not allowed to say what it is?
I have no idea. He just did it and it's good.
Yeah.
But it looks a bit strange. But when you take it off, the guitar has more dead spots.
Right.
Maybe you can do the same effect with something else. I don't know.
I always like it though when you see things like this on people's guitars because you can tell that they care about searching for something. I remember hearing somebody say that like in the 70s, it wasn't cool to have... I think it was Tom Bukovac actually said this about... It wasn't cool to have a stock 50s
guitar.
Fender or something because... It showed that you weren't really looking for a new sound as a player. So I guess this is just another idea that, well, how can I make it just a little bit better and and achieve the sound in my head? Just that little extra 2% or something like that. I'm too lazy to do stuff like this. I take a guitar as it comes and just try and do everything from the hands if possible. But
do you have this kind of maniacs in the store at Peach Music or in your area? Do you have...
Oh, I guess so, yeah. I definitely... You know, I didn't work in sales at Peach, but I know that, you know, there's some real particular customers, which is that's what drives this whole industry. It's about that attention to detail. And when you break it down, it's such a simple thing. A guitar and an amp, really, that's what you need. Everything else is just little bonuses. So we need these bonuses to keep it interesting for ourselves and to find new little ways to express what we're trying to do. But the more time's gone on, the more I've realized I just like to keep things maybe a little bit more simple a lot of the time.
Yeah.
Because, you know, for what we're doing today, if you just want to have a jam with somebody, if I turned up and...
Had too many pedals, and something goes
wrong. Hold on, Thomas, can I just set up my 25 pedals and I need to... I've got a very particular tuning. I've got a very particular string gauge I need to use.
You know, Heiko knows me. the older I get, I give me anything, and if it's shit, it's shit. But I try to do my best.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
It is a nice challenge. All this double, triple, extra gear that it's causing more problems than you think. I mean, that's okay if you have a production show where you turn up and the band has
there's absolutely nothing wrong with it at all.
Yeah, there's different situations, and you have to find a way how to deal with each particular situation.
Yeah.
And back to Gary Moore, when I was at the Strat Pack, you know, Gary was there, and when he did his performance, he was on fire. Mm. And it was just like, here's my 61 Strat. He went for his Marshall, and it was dimed for sure. That's what, no prisoners. And it's like, you could hear when he was, but the moment he had, the soundcheck was just turning up the volume and getting some ugly noises, so he knew everything was working.
Yes.
And not taking, no, it was, he didn't care because he knew he can control it.
Yeah.
And he knew he had definitely enough gain if he wanted to.
Yes. He certainly did.
Yeah.
He certainly did.
The rest, he was ripping it off, and it was great.
But at the same time with Gary, you know, he had periods where he would use a lot of effects and a lot of gain, like you said. But there's also moments, I mean, I don't know Gary's music too well, but I did have a period where I really listened to him a lot. And
when you listened to Gary, what was your, can you name like three songs that, or like particular things
my favorite thing I've ever heard him play is a song, I forget the name of the album, but I can see the cover. He's sort of standing in, and he's in the rain. It might be called Back to the Blues or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
There's a song on there called I Love You More Than You'll Ever Know.
Mm-hmm.
And it's probably the best blues guitar playing
you have heard.
I possibly have ever heard.
Okay.
Yeah, and it's, I don't know if you know that particular song.
Nope, I should listen to that. Maybe I have that album, maybe
it's not. One of those long songs.
Yeah.
You know, it's maybe 7 or 8 minutes.
Yeah.
But the tone, I think it was like a Jules Showman or something.
Yeah.
With a Les Paul. And the tone is right, the playing is right, his vocals as well. That's something that people don't talk about with Gary enough. How good his vocal was and how it developed.
Over the years, I mean, during the hard rock days, he was getting real high notes as well. It's like, whoops, you know, when I was a teenager, I was never a singer, but I tried to, and I knew, don't do it, you know, because...
But he got better over time.
Yeah. And then, you know, his voice also, he found a way, especially with the blues singing, where it felt more organic. And I mean, of course, the rock screams, everybody tried to be the rock screamer back in the 80s. And it was a bit ugly. And today we can all have a good laugh on the hair metal. Yeah! He still got the blues. And what I admire a lot is that he sings a vocal phrase like, and still got the blues for... And while he picks up the note on the guitar, he has to end the phrase in the vocals.
Right.
So the vocals go down.
Yeah.
And he already plays a line on the guitar going up in a different... phrasing.
Yeah. It's like, it's a different part of the brain.
Yeah, he has two parts of the brain working, even with a bunch of alcohol.
Yeah.
And I've been there.
He knew what he was doing.
Yeah.
Yeah, good old Gary.
Yeah. So that's one song. Do you have another one?
Well, I remember, I think that the first Gary album I bought was, it was like a collection of his Montreux performances. So he played there, I think, in 1990, which is when he first started with the blues.
Yeah, still got the blues in Montreux, the first time ever.
Yeah, and I think he had some guests, Albert Collins and BB.
Yeah.
I don't know, actually, sorry, BB wasn't there, but Albert Collins was there.
Yeah.
Then it goes to 95, 97, into the 2000s. I don't remember the years, but it's really interesting to hear the progression.
Yeah.
Because in the early days, I think he was doing the Soldanos.
Yeah. Tons of gain.
Loads of gain.
And that changed.
Loads of hair as
well. Yeah, yeah.
Big hair.
Yeah.
And that's amazing. And then you jump forward 5 years, and it's interesting because it's in the same setting, I presume, you know, same venue, maybe a different band, I don't know, but the songs change as well, and he started to bring back more of his kind of the Irish Celtic influences. So there are definitely some songs, and again, I can't remember the names of them right now, but on those live Montreux albums, he would do some of these more kind of Irish-influenced things, and that was such a unique sound. No, I don't know of anyone else that really did that combination of high-gain guitar, but with all this melody, this Irish melody.
I think that was one of his strengths, and maybe he's... I mean, Rory Gallagher had a little bit of that too.
That's true.
But Gary Moore had really nailed it. Even in the in his hard rock days, Over the Hills and Far Away was one of those stadium rock.
You hear versions. It's little nuances. So it's I'm going to embarrass myself now. I'm trying to play some Gary type things, but it's little licks like those kind of licks which. That's not a usual guitar. It doesn't fall under the feet. Yeah. It's not. Yeah, that's very. That sounds very Irish to me.
Yeah.
And that's something that Gary did. What's the story with this? Because this is a very nice 335.
I bought this when I was doing clinics in my 20s. In music shops, and back in those days, they were always sitting, you know, some used guitar sitting in shops, and I kind of spent more money on that than I earned, because you know I found these guitars. This is a 64 335. There was some whatever Bixby or something on it. I don't care, you know. It's a great guitar. And the story of that is I bought it in North Germany, I think Oldenburg or, you know, somewhere there. And give me a little bit of sound. Yeah, I just this guitar is killer. I don't know.
Are they the original pickups?
Yeah, yeah. This is at least this is what how I bought it. Mm. But back in those days, I don't think the guys changed the pickup on this kind of guitars.
No, I guess with a 335 especially, unless you absolutely have to get into the electronics.
Yeah.
You don't want to touch
because the wiring. If you try to change the pots and get the wires out of the 335, it's a nightmare. So don't touch a 335 as long as it lives.
Yeah, if it's working, just leave it alone.
Exactly. So. Guitar, you know?
You know, that's the sound
that
I think a lot of people don't appreciate on an, especially on an old Gibson. Mm-hmm. It's always a test as well for me if I play a Gibson guitar. The middle position.
Yeah.
Because there's such, most people just go, okay, yeah, bridge, great, the neck, great.
Yeah.
Everything is in the middle for me.
I do agree, especially on the Gibsons, because there's that extra little spankiness that I know from my Strat. Mm-hmm. Background, and that helps me. I don't need a fat, what is it, American?
No.
It's not the thing that I'm after.
It's just right for me, and it's a good test of a Gibson guitar, you know, because again, I don't know what this sound will be, but I just turn both volumes down to about 6.
Yeah.
It's an overdriven sound, but. Everything is there. Thank you. But you know what I mean? That's not that's not the Gibson sound that, that people think of. It's such a great sound.
I totally agree.
And then, you know, if you need a little more treble, turn that one up a little bit.
Yeah.
If it's too bright, you turn that one up a little bit. And
it's all there.
So I live in the middle position.
Yeah. And you are living in the 50s wiring.
Very important. Yeah.
See, that's if you have the modern wiring, it's not as musical, because for me, the interaction of the pots and the colors you get with the 50s wiring, that's us.
Yeah,
I guess.
Yeah, I get it, and I'm sure a lot of people watching it, you know, understand that stuff too. It's like I was saying earlier, you know, these little details are the things that keep us interested, and how can you be even more expressive if possible, and it's in those little details like that.
Yeah. So when you are in the UK, you are still with Peach Guitars, or what is your current?
No. So I left Peach around a year ago now, and I had a great time there. I was there for about 5 years, and definitely got to play a lot of great instruments.
Gears, of course. Gears.
And the most important thing for me was meeting so many great people as well. That's what teaches you more than any amount of gear does. And so now I'm lucky to carry on just working with artists was kind of the thing I wanted to focus on more. Just playing as much as possible. And I'm lucky to still have a good relationship with certain brands that I really loved.
Sure.
So Bad Cat, of course, is one of those. And that's why I'm over here to do a little clinic tomorrow. With the guys from Bad Cat and the guys at 6 and 4.
Yeah, so if you are local, I know some guys are local watching us. We have the percentage is, I don't know, maybe only 5%. We have a lot of people all over Germany, but also second biggest group watching us here is the US.
Okay.
So you will be famous in the US.
Cool. Well, get on a plane. Come over to 6 and 4 tomorrow.
Exactly.
If you've got nothing to do.
You can still make it if you jump on the plane now.
It's an American amp company.
Yeah.
So the idea really tomorrow is that anyone who wants to come down can explore the full range.
Yeah, the different amps that you have. And you are familiar with all the different amps, and you can show all the details. And they all have like different characters and different philosophies. And that's the good thing about, you know, music store, and especially Heiko's music store. There is rooms, you have the time to do the whole thing. And that's and it's a very nice vibe in the store as well. So
I'm excited to see it. I haven't been yet.
Yeah, you will. It's not Peach Guitars, but it's something special, just as Peach Guitars.
Cool.
Which is good. Hey guys, we have another hour of an interview with Mr. Geoffrey Whitehorn. Geoffrey Whitehorn, you know him?
Oh, okay. Yeah, I've never met him, but I know.
I met him many times.
He's from around my way.
And he is. I was recording this interview with him just before the live part, so we'll put that in now. And well, Jeff is such a English gentleman, killer tone guy, and he's unique. He was one of my heroes when I was going at trade shows. He was, back in the days, he was the Marshall demonstrator.
Right.
And he had the tone in his hands. And he was always like, this sounds delicious. And then he had his self-rolled cigarettes. Back in the days when people were smoking.
Yeah.
And a drink. And cool. And then he...
The real deal.
The real deal, yeah.
Nice.
And he played with The Who for 1 year in Madison Square Garden. So Roger Chapman and a lot. So Jack, thanks for joining here. You know,
it's a pleasure. Yeah.
Yeah.
Nice to see you again, Thomas.
Nicer
to play with you.
Oh,
as well, as it were.
Always a pleasure. And people check out the workshop at 6 and 4 tomorrow.
Yeah,
and now you can watch Geoffrey Whitehorn, myself, talking about Gary Moore, his life, his style and the rest. This is the longest live stream we have ever done, but still enjoy. See you guys.
Cool.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Geoffrey Whitehorn, straight from the UK. Yeah, it's great to have you back. And I found this very old but super nice picture of the two of us. I don't know if you remember that one.
Oh, weren't we young?
Oh, yeah. I was in my early 20s. I think the one on this side was in Paris, some Salon de la Musique.
Yeah, yeah. I remember that one. Yeah.
Yeah.
And we're both drinking a beer.
As we should, you know. This were the
how unusual.
And the other one here, can you see there is Nico McBrain, I think, from Iron Maiden.
Yeah, yeah, when we had the Marshall band together.
Yeah. Yeah, right. Yeah. Right. So Geoffrey always has been my hero on the trade shows because of his tasty playing, his great phrasing, and the way you move with the guitar moved me. And I can tell this way, when you bend a note and when it sounds right, when you work the note Whitehorn style, wow, it always got me. I loved it. And
it's all blues, Thomas, just blues.
Yeah, but you had the blues back then, and I was so young, and I was experienced the blues through you, through the rock music and the blues influence, which is so cool. Hey, I found a record that I, maybe you remember that one.
Oh, wow. that's older than you.
Probably. This is old. 70, whatever, or yeah. Yeah, so cool. Yeah, so for me, you are one of those, I would say, British rock guitar players with a tradition in tone and with a foundation that, as I just said, inspired me a lot. But of course, today we talk about Gary Moore, who was also a very big influence on me. When I saw him the first time, I was shocked because of his sheer energy. It's like, what is this guy doing? You know, yeah. I remember when I think at that time, when this was happening, 80s with Ian Paice on drums and the Corridors of Power album. He was appearing in German Rockpalast or some, and I switched on the television and I was like, I couldn't believe. I mean, you know, this guy was on fire.
And I remember watching that Rock Palace with my daughter at the time, who I think was about two. obviously I knew Gary, I knew what to expect, but she was mesmerized. Yeah.
At the age of two.
She loved it, you know.
Yeah.
Which is really weird, but I mean, good taste, you know.
Yeah. Good taste and very emotional. And I think that emotion talks to people of any age.
Yeah. That's it. I mean, Gary just had that real feel. I mean, I don't know if it was, you know, anger or what, but I mean, you know, he was still a fairly young guy, really.
Yeah.
In fact, we were born within, I don't know, 8 months of each other or something.
Ah.
And obviously we grew up on the same stuff with the same influences. Very much Eric Clapton,
yeah.
Peter Green, Jeff Beck, the usual suspects.
Especially in the UK, it's like those threes. And I have to admit that when I started to listen to guitar players, I was also influenced by Steve Lukather, the American guys, which came later. But, you know, me being a bit younger, I didn't have that kind of history background. So the first time I listened to Hendrix, I didn't get it because I thought the guy is out of tune and maybe in some drug universe. Later, I fully got it and I fully went Hendrix all the way because yeah, but it took me a while to get it. But you have been there from the first.
I didn't get Hendrix immediately either. I mean, okay. The first time I saw him was on a it was on a TV program called Ready Steady Go in England. It was on every Friday, sort of early evening, about 6:30 or something. Mm-hmm. And this guy was, you know, he was playing his guitar over the back of his head and playing it with his teeth, and he was doing HO, you know. And I didn't quite catch his name right, and I went down to my record store, you know, and asked for have you got the new record by Jimi Henderson?
Yeah, Henderson sounds a bit more European, no?
I didn't get the Hendrix thing at all, you know. And they said, Do you mean Jimi Hendrix? I said, Yeah, hey Jim, Jimi Hendrix, hey, Jimi Henderson, whatever. give it to me now.
Yeah, unbelievable. So when you told me before that you were kind of close to Gary Moore, or you know him for a very long time. So what's your background? I mean, he is original from Ireland, and then he moved
absolutely.
So what's his story? What did you experience?
Well, he came over to England first with a band called Skid Row. Mm-hmm. Obviously not the American Skid Row, the Irish Skid Row. So, at the time, I still had a real job.
What was your real job then? Tell me.
My real job, I was a telecoms traffic something, or superintendent.
Oh, super is important, yeah.
Super, absolutely, yeah. TPS. And I was 20, I guess, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Which would have made Gary 19, whatever, 19 and a half. We were the same age, but, you know.
Yeah.
And, it was in London, and I used to, always after work, I'd go and hang out in the guitar shops in the West End, mm-hmm. in kind of Charing Cross Road and Denmark mm-hmm. Street. And because my office was only kind of 400 yards around the corner, it was too easy, you know.
Yeah.
And I used to go into a store called Orange. I think before they were making Orange amplifiers even, it was just an Orange guitar store, you know. And they had all these old Gibsons and Fenders and all this stuff. And all of it was cheap, relatively cheap. Mm-hmm. If I'd known then what I know now, I'd have been a very rich boy. But yeah, Gary used to, I think he was being managed or whatever by somebody associated with his store. And he used to hang out in there all the time. We just got to know each other, you know, pulling guitars off the wall and making a noise and not actually buying anything.
Mm-hmm. Annoy the shop owner.
just being a couple of sort of annoying kids, well, 20-year-olds.
Yeah, you know? Yeah.
But I mean, Gary could sit in the corner with any guitar,
yeah, you know,
just like a Strat or a Tele, and play really, really quiet. Mm-hmm. And he would break your heart with three notes. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, he had the blues. I had the Eric Clapton album. it's not quite the same. I mean, Gary was the real deal from the off. You know, he was just so good, such a natural. You know? And he was really quiet, really quite shy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he was a lovely guy. You know? And we used to see each other over the years, of course, you know, on different festivals and stuff. And And he was great. He, funny enough, when he joined Coliseum, I was in a band with the singer who subsequently joined Coliseum 2. Guy called Mike Stars.
Coliseum.
There you go.
And there's another Coliseum.
Yeah, this was Coliseum 2. The singer was a guy called Mike Stars. He was in the band that I was playing with. There you are.
Yep.
And Gary used to come down to the pub where we were playing, you know, while they were putting Coliseum 2 together.
Yeah.
And of course, he never went anywhere without Greeny.
Yeah.
Without the Les Paul, you know?
That 59 Les Paul that he got from Peter Green.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. And, I mean, he let me borrow it for a set, you know? Mm-hmm. And then he got up with my band and he used my guitar, mm-hmm. for, you know? And guess what? I sounded exactly like me.
Sure.
He sounded exactly like him.
Yeah, I mean, this is how it should be. It's real personalities. And I mean, honestly, you have that personality that really touched me when I was walking on the trade shows. You know, your tone was your tone. And I could hear it from all the whittlers in the whittly corners. There's only one Whitehorn, you know? You had a style. You had those notes, the right bending. And I know when you do this, yeah.
That means I'm sweating and my glasses are sliding down.
Yeah. No, the tone was right. I can tell. Of course.
I grew up on the Shadows and the Beatles.
Yeah.
You know. So, I mean, the first thing was always melody, to be honest.
Yeah.
You know, and then the blues thing came along with Eric initially with the Blues Breakers, the Beano album.
Yeah. You know?
And then Peter Green and then the whole thing exploded, really.
I believe that this kind of common ground for all you guys in the UK having similar influences, still yeah. Everybody has its own little nuance in the German guitar players, for instance, I find them slightly different. Like Uli John Roth, for instance, is very classical, you know, mm-hmm. And there's this kind of, I'm a German professor and I have to play the arpeggios the right way. You know, there is a certain, it's not a harsh element, but it's very German in a way. And you guys.
It's very kind of disciplined.
Yeah. This is another edge.
I'm not going to make any jokes, but yes.
At this age where we are now, we are allowed to do any jokes. I mean, we all can handle it. And even, you know, even when you talk to Uli, he has a great sense of humor.
Yes, and he does.
Yeah. And you can do anything with him. He's super open. Even sometimes you think this guy is super serious, but there's the other side in all these personalities, which is so great, especially when we are all getting a bit older and don't take everything so personal and serious anymore. Yeah. We have a great laugh on ourselves. And this is...
With Uli, you never... I mean, I've met him a few times going, you know, over the years, and you're never quite sure if he's being serious or if he's taking the piss or not.
And that's the trick. That is the trick, you know. And that's cool. But anyway, so back to the foundation of the British rock melody combined with the melody, in that sense is kind of unique for the UK guys. When you listen to American or like German or maybe Italian guitar players, there's also melody or Ingve, but it is different. And for me, that English taste, you know, it's just like a dish. It's the English taste. It's let's go and have some proper good English music, like go to a good English restaurant, which nowadays is probably Indian.
Yeah, we don't know. There's no such thing.
Yeah,
all Indian, but, Indian, Italian, Chinese, Thai, you know, we've got everything. Yeah.
But in music, it's English. And I always admire that English style, that English taste, that English choice of notes, wherever it came from. I mean, everybody in your age group tells me the same story. Everybody has a slightly different touch and feel because of the personality, but you can somehow tell similar roots. They all have that melody, and it's not it's very intense and it's very meaningful. It's the right notes. It's I always admire those notes, the note choices that you guys have done. Not thinking about what it is, it was just a taste that I like. Oh, I like that. I like Geoff Whitehorn. I like Gary Moore. You know, and
say Richie. You know, Richie Blackmore.
Yeah.
You know, and David Gilmour.
Sure. Yeah.
It's kind of Richie is more into the kind of classically thing. There's still a lot of blues in there.
Absolutely. Yeah. And that kind it's of nice. Good. The balance of the blues and that kind of rock meets melodic, which is, that's the British mélange. Mm-hmm. Mélange à trois. No, very good. Yeah, so back to Gary. When you met him, he did have Greeny by that time already?
No, he didn't. But he met Peter Green at that stage. From what I understand, Gary really wanted the guitar. We all wanted the guitar. You know? I mean, this was a year or two later, I guess, when I first came over. But he got to know Peter Green, and from what I understand, Gary had an SG.
Yeah.
Right? And, Gary had said to Peter, "Look, I really want to buy your guitar." And he said, "Well, you sell your SG, and whatever money you get for it, give it to me and you can have Greeny." And I think it was like £110 or something. Silly. Ridiculous. Because even then, those guitars were changing hands for probably £400 or something. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I bought my gold top in 1972, and that cost £375.
Yeah, and we're talking about a real deal 1957 gold top Les Paul.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Whereas a real deal Sunburst, 58 or 59, would be 400.
There was a little bit more. Yeah.
Yeah, a little bit more. But I had everything before I had that gold top. I mean, I had 335s and SGs and all sorts of stuff. I mean, I had a 62 335 that I think I paid £150 for. Mm-hmm. With PAFs. Mm-hmm. And all those bargains were there,
This one is a 64 335.
That's lovely.
And I bought this in my early days with Houston Kettner when I did the clinics in the stores. It was sitting there in the corner, and I don't know, it was maybe 800 Deutschmarks or some, it was even pre-Euro.
And yeah, of course, yeah.
And killer guitar. Basically, all my expensive gear, all my expensive stuff I bought 20, 30 years ago when I knew it was cool. I picked the right amps. I picked the old Marshalls. I picked the old Vox. I picked the Fenders. And they all came from that clinic tours when I spent more money than I made.
I think they all did that. Yeah. I mean, when I bought the Les Paul for £375, that was kind of a lot of money at the time.
At the time,
I was probably earning, £20 a week or something.
Yeah.
So that's like, 3 or 4 months' wages.
Sure,
However, what they're selling for now is a little bit more than 3 or 4 months' wages.
Absolutely. Yeah. So when you met with Gary in that Orange Music shop,
I'll tell you a Les Paul story. When I was about 12 or 13, we had a local music store, and there was this brown Les Paul in the window, this brown Gibson in the window. It was probably around about 63 or 64, I want to say. And this guitar sat there for months and months and months. And it was up for 100 guineas, which at the time was £105, okay? Mm-hmm. And it sat there and it sat there and it sat there. And eventually somebody bought it. I didn't want it. I didn't want a brown guitar. I wanted a red Stratocaster like Hank Marvin's, And anyway, somebody eventually bought it, and the guy who bought it eventually sold it. He sold it on event after a year or two. He didn't really like it. And he sold it to a music store in London for £30. and this was a genuine 59.
Nine Les Paul, yeah.
My blood. Who knows? Yeah. £30.
Pounds. Yeah. For today, dream on. You will never get there again because now the world knows. And but on the other hand, I like your way also of demystifying those you know, holy grail guitars and pickups. You gave me a set of 57 pickups, which are lovely, absolutely great sounding. And of course, on the one hand, it's exciting to have super high value gear that I don't even own, but I have the chance to once in a while play. Some of the guitars are really great. I'm not saying that this is not worth the money. Well, it's not worth the money in my world, but in collectors have a different mindset. But there's still some great guitars, and that's exciting me about these guitars. But on the other hand, I want to demystify everything that is kind of, oh, without the whole, you know, I have the Holy Grail and you have not the Holy Grail, and I'm right. Good. And you know, that's all bullshit. You know, that, you know, I mean, and back to Gary Moore, I'm sure he can play any guitar from anywhere, put some strings on there and be himself. And everybody else has to cry because he was so good.
Yeah, and I mean, same thing. Obviously, Gary was, you know, he was the best of our little age group, you know, like myself and Bernie Marsden, for example, Mickey Moody.
Yeah.
Clem, I guess, Clem Clemson.
Yeah.
You know, we were those few years behind the magic guys, you know.
Yeah.
All aspiring to go, you know, in that direction. But yeah, you know, and every one of us sounds completely different, you know.
Yeah. And when we look back at Gary's career, there was like Skid Row, and then there was Thin Lizzy. And did you have any contact during that time to Gary? Did you hear any, what was happening in his life? Was he excited? Because, you know, from the today's perspective, it's like some people only know him as the guy that plays the blues. They don't know about the past, about, you know, prog fusion or jazz rock, as we called it back in the days. And then, you know, here, Corridors of Power, the album that is like 80s rock, hair metal, kind of, no?
Sure, sure.
And so did you have any insights on his different stages in the career? Why he changed? I mean, what happened?
To an extent, I mean, he was kind of in and out of Lizzy. He was in and then he was out again for a bit and he was in again. And, you know, and I mean, obviously there's some great evidence of his time with them, you know.
Yeah.
But then he, you know, he obviously joined, Coliseum, which is when I got to see quite a bit of him again. You know, we were both here and there around the world doing whatever.
Yeah.
But obviously he'd learned all sorts of stuff. I mean, I remember, you know, every time that a Jeff Beck album came out, for example, you know, he would buy it on the day it came out on the Friday, and by the Saturday he'd have learned it.
Yeah,
you know, I mean, he was that good.
Yeah,
he could just hear a thing, mirror it, play it straight back at you.
Wow. You know? Yeah,
just great ears, superb ears. You know, and I mean, some of that Coliseum stuff's pretty tricky.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. And he went from a straight kind of, you know, blues rock background into this, sort of, I mean, call it, I don't know what you call it, fusion, whatever, jazz rock-ish kind of thing. And he could do that just as well. You know, he made that same sort of transition that, if you like, Jeff Beck made from, you know, straight blues rock into something a little more grown up.
Yeah. And then when the 80s came, he went for him as the rock star, being the singer, the front man, and having a hairdryer to look.
Oh, yeah.
and hairspray.
Yeah, lots of hairspray.
Yeah.
And sort of knee length leather jackets and tight trousers, all that. Platform boots.
Yeah, and this is how I heard him the first time with that red Stratocaster. And now I only know it's a 61, just like what I have myself. Where's mine? Ah, it's sitting in front of me.
Well, there you go. I mean, that's a great sounding guitar, but is you playing it? So I don't really know if it's a good guitar or not.
Well, for me, it's a good guitar because I tried to make replicas of that guitar, and and they are pretty good now. But we are at number 47, so it took 47 guitars to get that close now, and that's the good thing for me. That's a challenge, a personal challenge. How to get a good spare guitar? My first spare guitar was made out of original Fender parts, like original 1960 neck, because it should be 61 as close as possible. Original Fender bridge, original everything, original. And guess what? The guitar was not like my main guitar. And then I learned that one day I had a different body that was not even a Fender body, but it sounded much better. So, why do I have to stick to the brand? The neck is still there and it's still a great guitar. And now I try to decode the recipe or the DNA, and with other components, I got even closer. And it's a Japanese neck and blah, 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 whatever. It doesn't matter. But it's like, I kind of like to have challenges like that and things that I can improve over time. You know, it's like when you build your own guitars, every new guitar tells you, you learn a little bit more, right?
Well, yeah, I mean, you never know how they're going to sound until they're finished. You know, I mean, you can do the, you know, the poor wood tapping best thing and all that, you know, which is all very well, but it doesn't prove a whole lot, to be honest. You know, and I mean, you're going to sound the same on your vintage copy anyway.
Of course, yeah. This brings me back to some memories when we spent sometimes at JHS in North England, where you had the Fred King signature guitars, with Trev, and I still have my vintage. I have the cheaper one. Ah, here we go. Yeah, Fred King all the way. And you are the man that came up with the idea of that humbucker. And I think you have a one pot is connected to one of the coils, so you can, what's the trick about your Fred King wiring?
The back tone control just taps a humbucker. Interesting. Okay. And the middle tone control, I mean, they work volume tone, just like Strat.
Yeah.
But the middle tone, it still does the tone for the neck pickup and the middle pickup. But when you press it down, you can get the humbucker and the P90 together. So one and three. And obviously in the in-between positions, the two and four positions, you can get all three pickups on. It's just that bit more versatile, so you can get Telecaster sounds as well.
And I remember the days when in what was the town called Garforth near Garforth. Leeds? Garforth. Yeah, there was always a great jam with the demonstrators or the guys that came along, like you, myself, and who not, the drummer from, I don't know, do we have any, who was the drummer? Ah, and the American guy, Matt Smith.
Yeah.
I remember playing with him and he did, Help With My Friends. Mm-hmm. And he could sing one note like forever, like, and he, you know, it's like, okay, he is a big guy, but I mean, he had a different trick. It was like amazing. Yeah.
Funny guy. Yeah. And I just remember a lot of drinking at those things.
Of course, I remember that too. But there was everything. There was a lot of drinking, a lot of cool people, and a lot of nice music. And that's a little bit sad that this kind of industry tradition, and it was nice to be at these events somehow.
Yeah,
I enjoyed it.
Like, you know, Frankfurt was always fun.
Yeah.
You know, NAMM was always fun. You know, I mean, eventually, I mean, I did it for a lot of years and so did you. And eventually, she got to meet kind of everybody that mattered, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. Because they all came to these events. Yeah. And then, it was so good to connect with the people. And it's a different level when you go on on tour. Mm-hmm. On tour, I met different people. Mm-hmm. And at these trade shows, at these messes, you met those people and other people. And that opened up the horizon. And I'm very, very happy and very thankful to have been there, that did a lot for me to be connected to nice people like yourself. Well, because,
you know, and vice versa, you know. Yeah. When I remember, you know, going to, you know, one of the NAMM shows, and I ended up, you know, in one of the halls, you know, standing at a bar with like Seymour Duncan, Luke, the pedalboard guy, you know, all these legends, you know.
Yeah.
And you're sitting there having a beer with them. Very
yeah.
Nice. Like,
yeah. Super cool. Yeah.
Mm.
And one more thing about Gary. Okay, guitars, amps. Can you tell anything about amps? We all know he played Marshalls. He was super. He was seen with Marshalls mostly.
Usually set to 10.
Well, that's the point where a Marshall comes alive.
Yeah, no, he came, like I say, he came and played with my band in this pub. And I had a Marshall 100 and a 4x12, you know.
Yeah.
I used to run it on about 3, because
mm-hmm.
that was about all I could get away with, you know. But, you know, Gary came in, he plugged in, you know, plugged Greeny in and just went like that. Cross. So everything was on 10, you know.
Yeah.
And he sounded fantastic.
Of course. I had that experience last year with the Rottgau Monotones. Remember the German band? Ali, the guitar player. Ray, the other guitar player, passed away. So they had a 45th anniversary of the Rottgau Monotones, and they had to invite a second guitar player. And Ali, being a friend like we are, he asked me to be with him on stage.
Oh, excellent.
And I played his original Royal Grande Marshall amps, you know.
Yeah.
And guess what? I brought a pedal, and then I thought, you know what? Fuck it. Plug in, do this, and the rest and the rest is the volume control on the guitar. And the sound guy didn't even complain because he was used to that. So I mean, if there were like 8,000 people, really big venue, open air, so there was not an issue. It was not a pub gig, but and the sound guy was totally fine. I myself was sometimes moving a little bit out of the center of that 4x12 because it bites.
Yeah. Well, it was a little bit different having a 100-watt Marshall on 10 in a small pub.
I know.
You know,
I've done it.
Gary didn't care. It's like, fuck it, this is what I do, you know.
I had that experience with my 50 watt Marshalls, and my lead singer went like with red eyes, nearly ready to kill me, you know. It's like, but I told him I have to make that real deal experience like Jimi Hendrix. Are we serious or are we not? And he said, okay, we are serious.
Exactly.
I've done it a couple of times in small clubs, and then I had that Power Soak SE100.
There you go. Yeah.
Yeah.
Which kind of wasn't the same, but anyway, yes.
I do agree. But anyway, I've made my experience, so I've been there. And that's part of my Jimi Hendrix. You know, when the moment when. When I took some medicine and listened to Jimi Hendrix Experience, and I became experienced.
I know.
Yeah. Anyway, so amp-wise, classic guy, Marshalls, and I think one of his tricks was also to combine like overdrive pedals into an amp, because he knows how to use high gain.
Mm-hmm.
That's something that I learned from Gary in the way that, okay, you can have that puristic approach, which is great. You know, I'm not saying this is better, but it's like, in technical terms, he was using hard clippers in front of overdriven amps, which again do a hard clip on the power amp stage when you crank them and then have some, in technical terms, maybe he didn't know anything about that, but I can tell, clever guy, cascading gain stages.
Oh, yeah.
from in, and he had several cascaded, you know, in the pedal, in the preamp section, in the amp, in the phase inverter, and the power amp stage was saturating when you do that with a pedal, and it sounds killer.
I don't know if he used like a Tube Screamer or, you know, a Marshall Governor or something.
He did occasionally.
It was something like that anyway, and I mean that's how you get that note on Parisian walkways, you know.
Yeah,
that'll stay forever, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, apparently in Japan, when Gary used to go to Japan and do that song, there'd be little Japanese guys in the front row with stopwatches, seeing how long he could hold that note for.
See, that's a Japanese mentality, you know.
Oh,
yeah. Japanese are very precise. Oh, today, Mr. Gary Moore makes lesson, and he goes for
34 seconds, Jeff-san.
Jeff-san, Thomas-san. You've been there also quite.
I love it.
Me too. And the Japanese precision. I remember when I did a clinic, I was backstage waiting to go on, and then it was like, whatever, 30 seconds before or 1 minute, and I said, okay, when is showtime? Not now. So okay, and then like 10 seconds before whatever, 8, now, they forced you, you know, now is the time. Okay, so, you know, punctuality
to death.
And then you come on stage and your cable is curled just like fresh from the hairdressers. I mean, like, impressive, you know. Yeah. So you pick up the cable, you plug in.
Oh, sure. I mean, our road crews, any time I went to Japan, they never had to do any work.
Yeah.
I mean, they do some work on the first gig.
Yeah.
And then there'd be all these nice little Japanese guys taking notes and taking pictures and, you know, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
Everything was done for them from the next gig on.
Yeah.
You know?
And perfectly, you could rely on these guys, yeah.
Otherwise, they go and commit harikari, you know.
Yeah, yeah. I experienced a thing. Some guy was once late at a train ride from wherever, Tokyo to Nagoya, I don't even remember. And the guy was late for whatever reason. And hey, when the guy showed up with the next train, he was like, ooh. I've never seen... It was like the end of the world for this guy. And me was totally relaxed. I mean, you know, we are used to that. It's like, hey, as long as you come ready for the gig, everything is fine, you know? Who cares? Nobody starts without any fellow musicians, you know? Cool. And have you had contact with Gary at his final years? I mean, when he...
I'm trying to think. I think probably last time I saw him was the thing that we were doing down in. No, it wasn't. I had seen him since, but no, I don't. Oh no, actually, the last time I saw him was on a festival that I was doing with Chapo, and Gary was on. You know, like two acts later, you know, and he came and watched our set. You know, Gary's watching, you know, it's one of those, you know.
Yeah.
And he's sure. Kind of going, mm-hmm. And we before his set, you know, we had a nice drink together. I mean, I'd done my thing, so I could have a drink.
Yeah.
I think Gary was quite nervous, and he got well stuck into some wine before his for his show, which was great.
Yeah.
But I think he suffered a little bit from kind of stage fright. I mean, I think we all do.
To a certain extent. But on the other hand, I met him at the Strat Award when 2004.
With Hank Marvin and all that.
And all them. I was there with David Gilmour and him. And I was introduced to him. And he was super sweet, but very kind of so soft. When I shook his hands, it was like I was expecting, you know, Gary Moore, and he was sitting on a flight case, and a soft, really soft voice, and a very mellow guy.
Yeah.
You know, I was expecting a different personality, and then
I think he was pretty shy.
Yeah, you know? I mean, the funny thing at this event, there were everybody. There was Brian May, there were David Gilmour, and I never will forget the moment when Gilmour entered the room. Before that, everybody was talking, blah, 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 blah. And then the door opened, Gilmour came in, and it was like Shine On Your Crazy Diamond. Oh, no. I mean, there was no, but you could have the soundtrack, everything slowed down, and he had this positive energy, you know, aura filling the room in a second, bam, you know, but Gary, when he went on stage, he was totally on fire.
He was almost like split personality, you know. He was always very quiet, you know. Like I say, he'd just sit in the corner of a music store and play really quiet and really tasty blues kind of things, you know.
Yeah, and this was exactly what he was there.
Put him on stage with a couple of marshals, and he was
animal. Yeah,
That Rock Palace you were talking about. Actually, I mean, like I said, I remember seeing that, and he was really, really good on it.
Yeah, yeah,
exceptional even for him. You know, he was amazing.
Yeah. And for me, this was a life-changing moment. This was like in my very, very early days, I just came from listening like vinyls records.
Yeah.
I think that this was pre-CD, right? Probably. Yeah. So, you know, listening to something and then switching on television. And then there was this guy like on fire, and I could feel this energy and this honesty and this, wow. And I could hear that Strat, and that concert made me buy a real Strat, because I had a Squire back then, like my first real Fender-ish. And then I asked, I want more. I want Gary Moore more. And the guy that is a guitar luthier told me, then you probably need an old one. No? Okay. And I said, okay, what's an old one? I didn't know that. You know, it's like, okay, well, he's playing some guitars from the 60s, pre-CBS. Okay. So, you know, me totally blonde, no idea. It's like, pre-CBS, where can I get it? And then like maybe half a year or a year later, the guy phoned me up from Hamburg when he was moving to number one, being in the repair of that thing that somebody was selling, a pre-CF's Fender, and one was a 61. So, and this was the cheaper one. So I bought that.
And how much did it cost you?
2,300 Deutschmarks.
What's that in today's money?
In euros, it would be 1,150 euros.
Right. I mean, there you go. You're that bit younger. When I first started doing session work, all I had was my gold.
Okay. Yeah.
My £375 gold top. and, you know, I started doing more and more studio work. And you know, some of the producers used to say, well, that's all very well, but, you know, we need something else sometimes, you know, different guitar sounds, you know. So I went and bought a 62 Strat, for £150. those were the days, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, I remember the first time I went to New York, you could go down West 48th Street, you know, and there were all the guitar stores down there, you know. And I mean, you could pick up 50s, like 56, 57, 58 Les Paul Juniors for like $99.
Wow. Unbelievable. Yeah.
Which is the equivalent of about 40, 45 pounds.
That's unbelievable. Yeah.
And I didn't, you know, it's like, oh, I don't want to, what do I want a Les Paul Junior for? You know.
Yeah, okay, well, yeah. And that's the difference why Joe Bonamassa's dad is making Joe rich now, because the mindset was already implemented.
Absolutely, Joe's got the right idea. You know? he's a good custodian of these instruments, you know.
Yeah, well, yeah, but I mean, but by the way, Bonamassa is also a big Gary Moore fan. And
he should be, yeah.
Yeah, and honestly, no, if I compare, I'm a bit mean now, but if I compare Bonamassa to Gary Moore, I would say, you know, Bonamassa is learned a lot of licks, but it's still not the real deal, you know, to me. I'm a bit offensive here.
Yeah, well, I mean he's a great copyist, you know.
I mean, see?
sometimes he sounds like Gary.
Yeah.
Sometimes he sounds like Eric Johnson. In fact, a lot of times he sounds like Eric Johnson.
Yeah.
You know,
the groups of five. Yeah.
You know, but yeah, I mean, you want to say, well, will the real Joe Bonamassa stand up? You know.
And that's the point. A guy like Gary or yourself, to me, has more of its own personality, and that's what draws me into your and Gary Moore's music, or, you know, Brian May. I mean, you know, it's uniqueness. That's a personal character. Nobody sounds like him. Nobody sounds like Gary, you know. And still, until that, you can try to shred blues, what Bonamassa is doing, but, you know, Bonamassa,
it's kind of blues by numbers.
It's blues by numbers because he is not experienced. We know we should get Bonamassa having the same medicine as Gary and see if he can learn that side as well. And then, I think Gary is a personality, and that shines through all his notes. If he plays that one note forever, you know, that's a statement. And when he goes and plays the high notes, and, you know, sometimes he does this, rah, 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 and it's like, where do you want to go? Is there more? Yes, there is more. And when when you think that's the limit, Gary Moore does one over the top. And that's what I love about Gary Moore's style, because he went all the way. He went beyond normal.
Yeah.
Beyond.
I remember meeting him at one of the, it must have been around about 87, 88. You know, and he's like, oh, hello, Gary, how are you doing? He said, oh, I'm doing a blues album. And this is late 80s. everybody's got, what, a blues album? What on earth? Why would you do that? You know? Mm-hmm. And I think he was probably, you know, one of the very first guys to do, you know, to sort of, I mean, almost spearhead that kind of blues revival, which is everywhere now.
Yeah. Today, every you know, every little pub makes a revival blues band.
Yeah.
And when he started that thing, I think Stevie Ray Vaughan was like the first one that appealed to me back in the 80s, where everything was like OMD or Orchestra Manouvre in the Dark and the Pet Shop Boys, you know, and the plastic synthesizer sounds with the splings blowing and Stock Aitken Waterman. And Never Gonna Eat You, you know, all this.
It's very nice, but, you know.
Yeah. And then. Yeah, and I think David Bowie was so clever to invite this Texas blues guy into a pop world album, Let's Dance. And then that changed a lot, because for me, that built it up And then Gary and other, but they were the first ones to actually smell that there is a big thing that's is a great thing to jump on and use this as a path of their career. Because for me today, the question is, what about all the metal guys? How they want to retire? Do they go speed metal at the age of 80? You physically can't do it. But I mean, there's a nice way of being older and playing the blues. That makes sense.
Yeah.
You know?
I mean, as far as the other stuff goes, you know, kind of speed and the virtuosity and all that. I mean, there's a million players out there. But all I will say to you is Matteo Mancuso.
Uh-huh. Yep.
Follow that. I mean, you can't.
No. It's the new, it's unbelievable, simply. So, but on the other hand, for me...
He's playing at Ronnie Scott's tomorrow night.
Oh, okay.
It's all sold out.
Too late. Yeah.
Maybe I don't want to see him, really. Maybe it'll be too depressing.
Yeah, I mean, this Italian guy is I saw it too, but in the end his style of picking makes that new technology, but for me is I can't imagine even this kind of technology with this kind of technique is okay music wise while aging, but imagine you are a metal guy and you turn 80 and you still have to go and you have to play these syncopated riffs that is too fast for a body at that age. Yeah. You know, maybe they have to change their future into stoner metal or, you know, something like not as fast.
Some of that Metallica stuff and, you know, even...
Yeah, even faster.
I mean, that stuff is, it's really horrible. It's tough to play.
Yeah, I mean, I can't do it. I can't listen to it. Sometimes I take it as a challenge. And it's like, I suck because my whole concept is totally different. Yeah. And I have to admit that this is a different genre of today's guys. I'm just wondering, I have a plan for my, like, future. I can go for ballads and blues and melodic stuff. I'm fine with it. I'm happy. But I wonder what these guys will be doing. I have no idea.
I really don't know. I don't know where you can walk to it. I mean, I'm going to be 73 this year, for God's sake, you know. And I mean, I still enjoy playing. Obviously, Procol Harum is no more because we lost Gary. And I'd be really happy if I never went to another airport again.
Yeah, you've seen it all. I know. Yeah,
not the air miles, but you know, touring has lost its attraction. Put it that way.
Yeah, I'm happy. I can see totally the point. I'm happy that I have done a lot of traveling in my younger days as well, going to Japan, going to the States 2 times a year and doing this and blah, 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 and being at airport. But I'm actually really happy after COVID, Zoom meetings are possible and I can stay home, you know?
Yeah. You can go to work without even putting your shoes on, which is great.
Yeah. And that's what we are doing right now. Hey, Geoff, thank you so much for sharing some of your life experience with Gary Moore and yours, of course. And I see so many guitars. We have to get you back here on other topics as well. There's so much, but thanks so much for now.
We lost Gary 13 years ago now. 13 years.
Yeah.
But he's still out there. You know?
Absolutely. And I discover what he inspired me in my playing just by preparing for this episode, listening to, you know, I went through my vinyl collection, which actually I haven't had a look at for years. Mm-hmm. And because I moved house and the whole thing was done. And then I was just cleaning the basement here and I went through all my vinyls and I found those vinyls and I put some on and I said, fuck, you know, it's really great. It's this amazing stuff. it's amazing. And if there are people listening to what we are just talking about, it's like, check this guy out. And of course, also check out Mr. Geoffrey Whitehorn, because he's got taste and he played with Roger Chapman, Procol Harum. And once you played with the Who, or what was that?
Yeah, for a little while. With I played first with Daughtry for a while.
Yeah.
But I played with the Who for a year, you know. Madison Square Garden, six nights at Madison Square Garden, no big deal.
No big deal. Okay. Okay, and I think.
Check out Ziggy Schwartz, Still Got the Blues album.
Yeah, see, and that's you again.
And yeah. Luke and all sorts of people. That's great. Neil Murray's on there. Mm-hmm. Not a bad album.
Great. Okay, thanks for being here. We have you back, definitely. All the best. Take care and see you soon.
I'm always on the end of a computer.
Same here. Cheers.
Ciao, Tommy.